Good morning. It's good to see you today in God's house. What a wonderful day it is to be together. It's beautiful outside. It's beautiful in here to see you. And the reason I say that is this is our second week back. And, you know, those many weeks in which we were preaching and singing to an empty congregation, it was different. And so we count it a joy that you're here today. I want to take just a moment, as you've seen the announcements that are up on the board. We will have a business meeting coming up in June, and so I would encourage you to make plans to attend that particular meeting. It's been many, many months since we've had a business meeting, and so let me encourage you to be here for that. Also, right after the service today, there will be a brief Sunday school meeting, and I believe it's in the fellowship hall. And so those who are Sunday school teachers, let me encourage you to be here for that. Before we continue any further in our time of worship, and I want to make it just a moment to pray for our country. And just, if you would, please, just bow your heads as we just lift up just the leadership of our country and those who may be in harm's way. So let's pray. Father, we count it a joy and a privilege to serve you, and we're grateful, Lord, that we have had the privilege of growing up in a free country. You've blessed us and graced us with that. We're thankful. But I pray for our leadership today, Lord. There's many things going on that are chaotic in the world around us. The decisions that they have to make are, Lord, they affect so many people, so we pray that you give them wisdom. And, Lord, we just do pray that the chaos would just quieten down. And, Lord, we just pray for the sweet presence of your Holy Spirit everywhere, but especially through us as a congregation, through us as the church, Lord, that we might shine brightly to share the gospel message. But, Lord, we know that that's the true change that will really make individuals turn from any direction, Lord, as they turn from all the other ways and they focus on you. So I pray that you'd help us as a congregation, Father, just to continue to be a beam of light, a lighthouse, Lord, that shares the gospel message. And Father, once again, we pray for your blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to take just a moment also to recognize a few special individuals. And I'm going to call them up one at a time. So I'm going to ask them to stand for just a moment, but in no particular order. But I'm going to ask Gwyneth if she would come up at this time. I want to present this to you from the church and tell you we're very proud of you. It's a wonderful achievement when you graduate high school. And now what are you going to do next? That's all I wanted to know. You may not know any more than that, but we want to let you know as a congregation, we're proud of you, and we'll be praying for you. So
Pastor,
if you would...
tell us what she said.
Oh, okay. She said she's going to college.
Anderson, so if you... University.
Anderson, okay. Well, good. If you'd stay right here. Jordan. And if you'd stand right here. And from the congregation, from the church, we're very proud of you, and we know it's a great accomplishment to graduate high school. And what is it that you think God has planned for you? What are you going to do next?
I'm going to welding school.
Welding school. Oh, good. That's a tremendous undertaking. So very proud of you, and I want to let you know that we as a congregation will be praying for you, and very proud of you. Kiernan. And you are graduating from college, and I want to, if you would please stand right here, I want to let you know that we as a congregation are very proud of you and very excited about what God has for you. We know that you've finished high school and now to college. What are your plans?
I'm hoping to teach physical education at a nearby school sometime soon.
Well, amen. Well, you know, we need good Christian influences in the public school system, and so I know that we as a congregation are very proud of you, very excited for God's path God has you on, and we're looking forward to to hear what God has done in your life and doing with you. And so we as a congregation, we want to thank you and just want to applaud you for a moment. And so before you are seated, if you would please bow your heads, I want to pray for you guys that God would bless you on your journey. Father, once again, we thank you for the privilege of coming to you in prayer. And Lord, this is an important day, Lord, in their life, not this day specifically, Lord, but as they transition from this step to the next step, to the next stage, Lord, the places that you would have them to go, whether it's welding school, whether it's Anderson University, whether it's teaching in high school, or teaching a school or the public school. It's a great endeavor. And Lord, they go forth as missionaries. They go forth as your servants, Lord, to impact the world around us. So we pray for your blessings on them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you.
I know we all feel that way a little bit right now, that nobody kind of can understand what anybody else is saying. And I've found that it's amazing to me how much lip reading I must do, because when people put a mask on, I can't hardly understand what they're saying. So I think we're all adjusting to that. But let's stand together, and we don't have to turn anywhere. We'll sing "I'll Live for Him." I'm still trying to figure this out, because I'm singing out of a book down here and we're singing out of a thing up there. So anyway, okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. And y'all pray for me as I'm trying to get through the rest of this. Dear Father in heaven, we're so thankful to be here this morning, as it's just so obvious that we're all have been disrupted, and the way things we've been doing are not the same. And we just pray that you'd help us as we make adjustments and as we go through all this time, that it wouldn't be an opportunity for the evil one to cause us to lose focus. We pray that we would not lose focus on you, that we would be able to see you as the mighty Creator God that you are, and that we could worship you in spirit and in truth. We pray that you would give us confidence to carry on and to do the things that you would have us to do, even amidst having to make adjustments. And most of all, Lord, we just thank you for your Son, Jesus, who came and lived a perfect life so that salvation was given to us, something that we did not earn. And Lord, help us to accept that gift. And Lord, help us, because you've done so much for us, to have the love and the desire to live our lives in a way that would honor and glorify you. And And the same be said for our church, Lord. We just pray that everything that we do here would honor and glorify you because of the precious gift that you've given us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And now we're going to try one that's probably a little less familiar to you guys, but you probably heard it before. This song was written in 94, I think. And that's a new song because our hymn books are always about a quarter of a century behind by the time music gets into them. But this is a little bit different this morning. So just Sherry will play through the first part of it and then we'll try to sing it.
Sang, talking about just the passion, having a passion for the Lord. I think that's important, you know, especially as I think about, you know, the graduates getting ready to spring off into the world, so to speak. Our prayer for them is that they would have a passion for the Lord. I'm going to ask you to take your Bibles, please, and turn to 1 John. Remember, in the New Testament, there's one big John and three little Johns. And this is one of the little Johns, but it's not little in content. It's one of the most pointed books in the New Testament about salvation. All of them are. But this one in particular, just he makes a point. John makes a point of wanting to ensure that everyone has an assurance of salvation. This is not a message today that's to undermine you're thinking about salvation, and that it's not even to make you question whether you're saved or not. It's intended to encourage you on the journey, to remind you of why you're saved and how you know you're saved. But our text this morning is 1 John chapter 1, and we'll begin reading at verse number 5, which we've alluded to a couple times over the last few weeks. 1 John chapter 1, beginning at verse 5. This is the message we heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And may God bless the reading of his word. Today, although we recognize the graduates, and I want to encourage the graduates today, I want to challenge them. But really, this is a message of challenge for all of us as well. Graduation for them marks the end of one segment of their life. It also signifies the new step and next step. It's much like someone's transition to retirement or to a new job or anything else that may come as one of those pivotal secular moments that really have some significance to them personally, to us personally. See, graduates are at a spot where they must make some major life choices. They may not immediately know. I mean, they may say, well, I'm going to college, but I don't know what's next. And sometimes they make a decision and they step back, and a few years later they make a new decision. But there's one choice, even though some of these decisions are not necessarily, you know, in stone, so to speak. There's one decision, one choice that you must decide. There's one thing that you must be uncompromisable about. You must choose to follow Christ no matter what. No matter what happens in your life, you must decide to fully put your hope and your trust in Christ. The world will seek to undermine your faith. It'll make you scratch your head and wonder what's going on. The world may even try to shame you to make you give up your faith. Well, as we read this morning in this passage of Scripture, that if you're quick to give up your faith, then it was probably never there. So stand firm in your faith. Stand firm in your commitment and your decision to follow Christ. It was Billy Graham who once said, there are many individuals who sit in the pews each Sunday and claim to be saved when in fact they're not saved. See, a Christian must be certain of their relationship. And there are a few telltale signs of whether a person is really a Christian or not. As you read this letter of 1 John, there are approximately 10 ways in which John describes and said, this is how you know you're saved. If you read 1 John, you will see the assurance of God's love for you. You will see the assurance of how you know that you're saved. There's a practical way in which you know. Certainly, as we'll discuss in a moment, it's putting your hope and your trust in Christ. But there are some things that follow. Many people claim to be Christians. Many people claim Christ. But there are very few who live in his light. You, as children of the light, which we talked about a few weeks ago, you walk in his light. So today, you must decide to follow him no matter what. This text is occasionally referred to as the principles of fellowship with God. But we also see some very clear evidence of whether a person is saved or not, as John describes some very simple truth. The first one is this. We see we must walk in the light of God's holiness. God is light, And with all the imagery that we can think of with light and all that it matters to us, it's important for us to understand that light refers to the holiness of God. Light describes his radiant perfection. There's no deviation of holiness in him in any shape or form. It means that he is absolutely free from everything impure, material, obscure, and even gloomy. Light was one of the first revelations in creation. Light reveals beauty. Light facilitates life. It facilitates growth. And it gives joy. Think about just what it's like after a week of rain. What it is to go out on a Saturday afternoon and to experience the warmth of God's radiant sunshine beaming down on your body and how it warms you up. And this is the image we have when we describe Jesus and we describe God as light. God is light. And in him is no darkness at all. God's light tells of his goodness, tells of the truth without flaw. Truth always seeks to spread itself around. It always sends forth its rays to penetrate everywhere and to dispel the darkness which oppresses us and opposes it. Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3 says this, Jesus is the radiance of his glory. So we see God is light, but Jesus is light as well. In fact, in this text of Scripture, this is talking about Jesus. We see him as the Son of God. His perfection, his sinlessness, his impact in the world around us. A few years ago, we went to Yellowstone, and there was a pool called the Morning Glory Pool. And it was noted because of its beautiful blue hue in the water. It was caused by a growth, a bacteria. Well, as people would visit this particular Morning Glory Pool, they would throw in coins. They would throw in trash. And little by little, this beautiful blue hue was tainted. It tainted it because there was a slight deviation in the temperature. And so the bacteria that made it turn blue couldn't grow. We need to understand, if there's even the minutest of little trash that's in our life, it taints our walk. It taints who we are. And so as we see God is light in his pureness and in his holiness, we too must walk in pureness and in holiness. We must not allow the thinking, the contaminants of the world to change us. See, that story about this pool, the Morning Glory Pool, reveals what happens when something less than perfect enters the scene. So you must understand that there's absolutely no blemish or no imperfection in God. His perfection is portrayed as radiant light. And John says if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we do not practice darkness. In fact, we practice light. And if we walk in the light and we practice darkness, the text tells us this. John tells us we're liars. See, the opposite of holiness and perfection is darkness and sinfulness. To the lost world around us, darkness is normal, and in some ways it appears as right. But you and I who have been embraced by the radiant light of the Lord God Almighty, we know the truth. That is why we try within all of our effort and all of our power to walk within the power and strength of his Holy Spirit. See, all the black and ugly things in this world are not of God. Adultery, pornography, murder, malice, strife, gossiping, busybodiness, cheating, lying, stealing, observing your horoscope, necromancy, hating your brother or sister in Christ. I want you to know something. I could really stand here all day long rattling off the many things that are darkness. Eventually, I would hit yours. Eventually, I would hit mine. And we all stand in that position. Things we need to deal with. So the list could go on. But those who are people of the darkness, they do not realize it's dark because of a conscience that has been seared or because of spiritual blindness. They've never seen the light. They've turned their back on the light. They don't observe the light, and they refuse to allow the light to change them. John makes a very clear contrast here. He says light and dark. There are not two items that are more diametrically opposed than dark and light. So living the light and living in the dark. And so when John uses this expression to walk in these things, he is talking about our practice or our pattern. So we either have a passion for light or we have a passion for dark. And we feed our chosen lifestyle. So what is it that you choose? What is it that you feed? But when we walk in the light, we become more like him. When we walk in the light, we begin to live for him. And that's the challenge. That's the encouragement that we would live for him. So we must walk in the light of God's holiness. Secondly, we must walk in the light of the gospel truth. To walk in the light means that we must fellowship. John says that there are some who falsely claim to fellowship. And this word fellowship is an important word in the New Testament. But here in John, the word koinonia is important. Koinonia implies that we have joint participation. We're walking with someone. We've locked arms together. And what John is saying is we are fellowshipping with the Father. We'll also see we're fellowshipping with other believers. But right here at this moment, when we're walking in the light, we're walking with him in fellowship. We're sharing together. We have a relationship with him. We look to him for absolutely everything. We trust him with our whole being. So if a person who remains in sin, it means that they are unrepentant toward that sin. It means they have no remorse for sin. They make sin their lifestyle. They walk in darkness. They practice darkness. They cultivate a life of darkness. Or we can walk in the light. And we can cultivate a life in which we're striving to honor the Father. We're striving to walk Jesus. You see, when we're walking in the light, we're walking in a lifestyle that pleases the Lord. The person who claims to walk in light, yet walks in a lifestyle of sin, lies, because the light of Jesus is not in him. There's no room for backsliding. One of the things you'll note if you read 1 John, it's very black and white, it's very yes and no. There's no in-between ground. It doesn't mean that we're sinless. What it talks about here is not sinless perfection, which we've mentioned. Do you know what sinless perfection is? It means that I believe that I live in such a way that I do not commit any sin. You say that's crazy that you would say that, but I've met people through the years who honestly believe that they do not sin. And part of it is because they measure themselves to the world around, and they think, well, you know what? I don't commit adultery. I don't steal. I don't do this and I don't do that, so I'm pretty good. All the while, we see that when Jesus, he elevated even our thought life to the point that even if we thought something, it was a sin. So if we meditate on a thought, even inadvertently for even a moment, it's sin. But not only this, we cannot actually believe in sinless perfection because we were born in original sin. That means all of us were born with sin hanging over us because of our original father, Adam, who sinned in the garden. So John is not talking about sinless perfection, but he says those who walk in darkness, they sin and they do not care. It's a pattern or a lifestyle of sinful activity, which a person no longer cares that they're sinning. Quite a few years ago, I had a relative who, just a few months younger than myself, and we were good buddies. We got saved fairly close to the same time. We went to church camp together, and we sang songs together, and we did Bible study together. But there came a time in which he started to have a struggle with drugs and alcohol, and he was even in a regular illicit relationship. But the entire time he struggled with his addiction and with his proclivities, with his sin, he struggled. He prayed about it and he pleaded, and it seemed like the harder he tried, the worse it got. He struggled, but the battle was lost one day when his truck careened into a telephone pole on the mill hill. And so people, when they hear that story, their first question is, was he saved? Was he a Christian? And do I think he was saved? And I said, I will always tell people this, I don't know. People who struggle with sin it's the natural human struggle we have. And let me say this, that if you're struggling with sin, it means that there's some light within you that is striving and trying to penetrate the darkness and trying to say, deal with this, work on this. But back to this relative of mine, I don't know if he was saved or not, but I do know this. He made a commitment to the Lord at a very young age. So I believe that indicated there was the possibility of that real relationship. And I want to stress this. Just because you're struggling with a particular sin, it doesn't mean you're lost. It might, in fact, mean that you're saved. Or it definitely means this, that God is trying to point this out to you and trying to draw that out of you and say, deal with this issue. Deal with this sin. So as he struggled to get out from the bondage of sin, he had remorse for what he was doing. He struggled because of his lifestyle and because it did not line up with the light of what was dwelling in him. And oftentimes we struggle with whether we're saved or not because of this very issue. There's light that's dwelling in us and our lifestyle doesn't line up. And so we really need to answer the question, are we saved? Is it God trying to pull that out, that sin to the limelight so we deal with it? Are we really saved? And he's trying to cause us to confess our sin. When we talk about confession of sin, it's caused by biblical remorse. It's more than just a conscience thing that is going on. Because our conscience can lead us one day in one direction and once again in another direction another day. We're talking about biblical remorse. Biblical remorse leads to conviction of sin. It leads a person to the confession of their sin. It leads a person to the rejection of their sin. A person without remorse has no light within them. Their lifestyle or their walk is reflective of living in darkness, actively going after the dark. A person that continues to live in sin, who claims to know Jesus, probably was never saved to begin with. That's what you see in the gospel or the letter of 1 John. See, the gospel truth compels us to take responsibility for our sin. Verse 8 tells us that there are many people who refuse to claim responsibility for their sin. This is how we know. We know that it's our sin and we must deal with it. You've heard people that have said, I'm just as good as another person. How is God going to send me to hell? The gospel truth compels a person to deal with their sin because they know that in the light of God's glory, we just don't measure up. None of us do. The gospel causes us to recognize our sin. Verse 10 tells us that some claim to be sinless. A person who claims to be sinless, they just don't understand the light. They don't understand the holiness of God. They think they're okay. We think the man in prison is worse than we are. We think that the felon is worse than we are. We think that the lawbreaker is worse than we are. When we all stand equally guilty in the eyes of the Lord God Almighty, when we stand next to the perfection of Jesus Christ, and his holiness, we are all sinful. None of us measure up, even the best of us. So we must be cautious. Some think they're pretty good. But those who have walked in the light, they know who they are. They know their condition. They know they need a Savior. Third, when we walk in the light, it's reflected in our actions. We fellowship. When we fellowship with God, we walk in the light. Remember, walking in is a practice. It's a lifestyle. It's not sinless perfection. It's a recognition of our sin. And we regularly confess our sin. We acknowledge Him. We fellowship with Him. Fellowship means we are an active participant in the gospel work, the work of the ministry. That is what God has called us to do. As long as we're here on this earth, as long as we follow Him, we are called to serve Him. We fellowship with Him. We fellowship with one another. Hebrews 10:25 tells us that those who forsake the assembly are just like the heathen. They're lost. Not my words, it's the word of Scripture. So it's important, it's essential for us to understand we fellowship. We fellowship with God. That's spending time with Him in prayer and Bible study. And yes, it's hard. It's difficult. It takes some discipline. But we fellowship with Him. We fellowship with our brothers and sisters. See, the bond of brotherhood and fellowshipping with one another is based upon the fact that we're coming together with others who have embraced Christ as Lord and Savior, those who walk with Jesus Christ. We come together through the blood of Jesus because the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all our sin. So we fellowship if we're walking in the light. We confess our sin, which we've already covered. God, when walking in light is a purging activity. It shows us our sin. Think for just a moment. When you're cleaning your house and you can't quite see what's in that corner, you might bring a light over. You might bring a flashlight over. I don't know what you do. But you want to see what's there to see if you need to clean it up. And the light of His glory penetrates every dark corner of our lives. It is the light of His Holy Spirit that begins to illuminate those areas that we need to deal with. And we need to confess. The tremendous light of God's holiness exposes the dark. The person that fellowships with God willingly allows God to expose those areas. One of those most difficult parts of growing as a Christian is saying, "Yes, Lord, take me, work on me." And when He starts doing that, and He starts showing you those dark corners, and you're saying, "Lord, don't touch that. Lord, I don't want to deal with that. Lord, I'm justified in what I'm thinking. I'm justified in what I'm doing." And He penetrates that spot with the light. We have to bring it to the forefront and confess it and deal with it and start walking in the light. The person who is fellowshipping with the Lord readily acknowledges and confesses their sin. We need to keep a short list of things that we need to confess. All of us have them. And John is not talking about living a perfect life. He's talking about living a life in which we confess our sin regularly. See, sin is a two-sided problem. It's a legal problem. There's a legal weight on our shoulders as a result of our sin, and it must be dealt with. It was dealt with by the propitiation, by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. But it's also a fellowship problem. Think for just a moment when you're out of fellowship with your spouse, when you just don't see eye to eye, it's tough, isn't it? But it's even more difficult when you're out of fellowship with God, but sometimes we don't recognize it. We don't see it. So sin has this two-sided problem that's dealt with by confession. The legal problem has already been dealt with. It's the fellowship problem that we deal with. We owe a tremendous sin debt, and when we're out of fellowship with God, we feel the weight of it. Jesus has offered to correct both. He offered to correct both of these problems with one trip to the cross. The blood of Jesus Christ covers all of our sin. And when we confess our sin, we are cleansed and our sin is purged. So when we walk in the light, we accept responsibility for our sin. We do sin. We acknowledge that we have sin. And a healthy dose of responsibility causes us to live a life in which we regularly confess our sin. And finally, we turn away from our sin. We repent. We were going in one direction. We not only just change course, but we head back to the Father. We head back to the light. So how does a person really know that they're committed to the Lord? How does a person really know that they're a Christian? Well, it begins when you have put your trust and your hope in Him. Let's say you've already done that and you're struggling. Then are you regularly confessing sin? Are you regularly dealing with the sin that God reveals to you? See, the Christian is known not just by their words, but they're known by their actions. And what do your actions reflect? What does it show? Are you walking in the light? Are you walking in the light? This morning, in just a moment, we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper. And I wanted to preach this message today for a couple of reasons. One, we're told in the New Testament that when there are some who take the Lord's Supper and bring difficulty, wrath upon them because they're taking the Lord's table in an unworthy manner. What does that mean? They're not living a life that honors Him. They're not living a life of confession and repentance. A life in which they are bringing honor and glory to the Lord. A life in which they're walking in the light. And so this is, in just a moment, this is a very serious matter. It's a tiny little plastic cup, but it's a very serious matter. It's a serious matter because as we think about what it means you need to take time for some personal evaluation. This morning, before we close and have our time in which we celebrate the Lord's Supper, I'm going to ask you to take just a moment to get right with the Lord. You may have come in this morning and you may have been all prayed up and fessed up. But maybe you haven't. Maybe there are things that you're dealing with. And in this time in which we celebrate the Lord's Supper, we're remembering what Jesus Christ has done for us. He gave Himself on the cross for us. He died on the cross for us. And what does He require of us? He requires that we come to Him with a contrite heart of confession. Embracing Christ as our Savior, embracing the sacrifice. And so if you would, please, I'm going to ask that you bow your heads for just a moment. And I'm going to ask that you search your heart, making sure that as you prepare to take this time of communion and the Lord's Supper, that you would take it very serious. So please pray. We thank You so much, and we pray that for each and every one of us here today that we would take serious this time, Lord, that it would not just be
an activity. But Lord, it would be a reminder of the death, the burial, and the resurrection. Father, that it would be a reminder of the great sacrifice that our Savior, who laid down his life for us, paid that day on the cross. Amen. I want you to take the cup that's in front of you here for just a second. And I want you to be aware of something as we prepare to receive this time in which we remember the Lord. There are two pieces of tape on the top of your cup. You peel back the first layer and there's the wafer. Peel back the second layer and there's where the grape juice is. This is an important time, and to be honest, this is one of those things that I really missed over the course of the last few months. Because this is such an important part of who we are. Jesus said to do this all the time. Do this regularly to remember what he's done. Luke chapter 22, beginning at verse number 7, reads this way. Then came the day of unleavened bread when the Passover must be killed, and he sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare the Passover for us that we may eat." So they said to him, "Where do you want us to prepare?" And he said to them, "Behold, when you have entered the city, a man will meet you carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house which he enters. Then you shall say to the master of the house, 'The teacher says to you, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' Then he will show you a large furnished upper room. There make ready." So they went and found it just as he said to them, and they prepared the Passover. When the hour had come, he sat down with the 12 apostles with him. Then he said to them, "With fervent desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took the cup and gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." Then he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. But behold, the hand of my betrayer is with me on the table. And truly the Son of Man goes as it has been determined. But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed." And so we come to this time in which we observe the Lord's Supper. It's given to us to remember and celebrate his broken body and his shed blood. And it was said that the night before he was betrayed, at the conclusion of the feast of the Passover, which he and his disciples celebrated, he took bread and having blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body, which is given for you." If you would, please. If you would, please bow your heads and pray. Father, it's just with solemnity on our heart, Lord, that we come to you. We remember the broken body. We remember the sacrifice that Jesus made on our behalf. Help us, Father, to walk in a manner worthy. Not that we're sinless, Lord, but, Lord, that we confess regularly and we walk in a sweet relationship of fellowship with you. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Hebrews, if you would please take, or turn to, Hebrews 9:22 says this, "And according to the law, almost all things are purified with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin." If you would please take the grape juice. First John 1:7 says, "But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all of our sin. 1 Corinthians 11:26 says this, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." And it was said that after the Lord and his disciples ate the bread and drank the wine, celebrating the first Lord's Supper, that they sang a song and went out. And I'm going to ask if you would please stand, and we're not going to hold hands, but we're going to sing, "Blessed Be the Tie That Binds." And we'll be dismissed at that time.
Blessed be the tie.